It's almost impossible to go a day in technology circles without discussing machine learning, the ability to train systems to learn about complex problems and develop nuanced and intelligent responses for them. Well, I say almost impossible, but it's actually pretty easy to do if you work in the games industry, as is perhaps evident by the suite of videos I've created over the years, be it in the main AI in Games series or here in AI 101. You'll notice that across the board, machine learning isn't as explored as heavily as other methods. But why is this? Well, it's really a reflection of how game development has historically operated. Machine learning has typically not been seen as a practical solution for many of the challenges that developers face, especially in non-player character design, with only a handful of exceptions to that rule. But with the most recent innovations in the field, particularly the boom of research in deep learning, this is beginning to change. But while we're seeing these new ideas creep into some familiar territory, such as your opponents in racing games like MotoGP, Forza and Gran Turismo, even in strategic adversaries in Age of Empires 4, it's arguably having an even bigger impact in other areas of video game production and is beginning to fundamentally change how video games are being made. I'm Tommy Thompson, welcome to AI 101 here on AI in Games, and in this episode we begin our journey into the world of machine learning. In the first of many episodes to come on the subject, I'm going to give you a very high-level introduction to machine learning and explain what it is, how it differs from traditional AI, the many different ways in which it can be created, and why it is now becoming increasingly practical to apply in the games industry. This means looking beyond the likes of non-player characters, and instead exploring how it's being used in player modeling, analytics, cheat detection, texture synthesis, graphical upscaling, animation blending, and much, much more. So let's start with the absolute basics. When we say machine learning, what do I actually mean? Well, to borrow from Stuart Russell and Peter Norvig's Artificial Intelligence, A Modern Approach, a machine learning system is built to adapt to new circumstances and to detect and extrapolate patterns. As these systems adapt and extrapolate these patterns, in theory, they improve at the task they're set, which we observe as humans as the system learning. You might wonder why we want to get a machine to learn to solve a problem, especially when us humans know what the problem is. Surely we can just write a program to solve it. Well, to borrow once again from Russell and Norvig, there's a number of reasons for this. Designers cannot anticipate all possible problems that the agent might find itself in. Designers cannot anticipate all changes over time. And sometimes human programmers have no idea how to program the solution themselves. And to embellish on that latter point, sometimes even if you do know how to get a basic working solution, it might not be as effective as figuring out how to get a machine to do it for you. And yeah, that's what a machine learning system is. It learns and adapts to information given and tries to extrapolate information from within it. If you're keeping up with the big innovations in AI research and development, you'd be forgiven for thinking that machine learning, and more specifically deep learning, is a new concept. But it's conceptually as old as other forms of AI. The AI techniques we've seen in AI 101 to date all conform to what is known as symbolic AI, of encoding human expert knowledge using some kinds of symbols and notation, which is then used to calculate solutions. The reason you might not have heard about machine learning prior to now is that, well, to be blunt about it, machine learning was kind of a dead end and failed to work at scale or with larger, more complex problems, while symbolic AI continued to deliver. However, machine learning has seen a new lease of life over the past decade, courtesy of breakthroughs in research, but critically the benefits of large-scale cloud computation platforms. This allows for bigger machine learning systems to crunch through larger quantities of data at speeds considered impossible even a decade ago. Hence, all the recent work in text and image generation tools, StarCraft 2 bots, and all the other weird and wacky innovations we see in the news nowadays, they have all benefited from this breakthrough. Now, our definition of machine learning is a very high-level one, but there are a myriad of different methods and techniques that we consider to be machine learning. We won't get into the specific implementation types just yet in this video, but I wanted to break the definition down a little further. Machine learning techniques are typically broken down into three specific categories: unsupervised learning, supervised learning, and reinforcement learning. Unsupervised learning is the idea that we can feed data to a system and then apply an algorithm and it will make observations from that data. This is a useful technique when you have a bunch of data to feed into the system, but you don't have a particular desired output. You're just interested to see what output it could determine. Perhaps you have data and you just want to figure out if there's anything interesting in that data set to actually glean. How can this be applied? Well, back in episode 31 of AI in Games, we looked at research in the Tomb Raider franchise that used unsupervised learning on player data to understand how players perform in the game. This project is one of the earliest examples of what we now call player analytics, which is now pretty much a requirement for any mobile, online, or live service game to monitor the behaviour and activity of the player community. Next up is supervised learning. This time around, you're feeding data into a system and you have an expected outcome that you wish for it to reproduce. So your dataset doesn't just include a set of inputs to the system, it also has a corresponding set of outputs, and we expect the system to learn the relationship between them. So, for example, if I have this list of numeric inputs, and then this other list of numeric outputs, you can see that the output is always the input multiplied by 4. By running a supervised learning algorithm, the system should learn that the underlying relationship is that the output is always the input multiplied by 4. Now, the trick is that, if trained correctly, the system should then be able to take any input that wasn't in the dataset you trained it on and still figure out the answer. Why is this useful? Well, if we have a bunch of data on a particular phenomenon, then we could try and reproduce that behaviour in known and unknown situations. And a great example of this is through player modelling. By feeding in information from the player, we can then train a system that reproduces the player's behaviour, and we can see that in action. Some notable examples of this from previous videos include the Drivatar system of Forza in episode 60 of AI in Games, and as discussed in episode 48, on Google DeepMind's StarCraft player codenamed AlphaStar. Critically, that the first phase of AlphaStar's development is that it learns to play like professional StarCraft 2 players by watching their replay data and trying to mimic their behaviour. The third and final branch of machine learning is known as reinforcement learning. This is typically used where we have an environment within which a system or agent can interact with it and determine a reward for what is deemed as good or bad behaviour in context of the objective. But the environment is often highly complex and difficult to learn simple yet effective strategies that can solve it for any given situation. Hence, in reinforcement learning, the system will learn what is called a policy. Through experimentation, it conducts an educated exploration of the problem, and over time it learns that certain actions are better than others, and learns to use these more frequently. Now you might be wondering, hey, what about deep learning? Well, deep learning is really a process of training what's known as a neural network using a combination of supervised learning and reinforcement learning, which is exactly what AlphaStar did. And that's a whole topic in and of itself, but think of deep learning as a subset of machine learning, and in the same way that machine learning is simply a subset of AI as a whole. So having covered the absolute basics, it's worth highlighting the strengths and weaknesses of machine learning versus more traditional methods, and some of this will help give context as to how it is now being used in the industry, as well as why it has not received much love until now. Machine learning, as we've already described, is about taking existing data and establishing the correct answers from that data. At the start, the system will make all the wrong decisions, and over time it will begin to improve, and from the outside in, we can pretend that it's learning like a human does. Though ultimately, all that's really happening is the algorithm is performing better at the task we told it to do. Now, this doesn't mean humans are out of the loop. We define the performance function that the algorithm will optimize against, we provide the data, we design the structure and configuration of the algorithm, but the system is then left to understand and build its own understanding of the problem and how to solve it. This often results in these systems developing a much more nuanced understanding of the data than what a human could provide in a similar timeframe. As discussed in my episodes on the Forza Drivatars and Gran Turismo Sophie, a machine learning-powered race car begins to recognize how to handle thousands of similar but slightly different configurations of turn types quite easily, but also they can adjust strategy for different road and weather conditions, and even the vehicle they're driving. But this strength inherently results in two big weaknesses. First, in order to generalize against that dataset, it needs a significant amount of data, not to mention time, to calculate the outcome. And if it doesn't do quite what you want, you need to hit the drawing board all over again, rewrite the algorithm and train it again, or gather even more data given it's not got enough to learn from. Now, further research in this field has led to a lot of ML algorithms learning and converging on smart behaviours much faster than before, but it's also compounded by the second weakness. After training an ML system, depending on the approach, it's nigh impossible to edit it quickly or add specific flourishes that, in the context of games, would enhance the player's experience. Designers can't crack it open to add unique behavioural tweaks with ease or remove a behaviour they don't like. In each case, you would need to change the restrictions being applied to the AI to capture these nuances, which of course incurs the expense of training it all over again. Ultimately, this all presents three distinct failings that, for the games industry, meant machine learning was not compatible. First of all, it doesn't support game development's iterative nature. NPCs in games go through a lot of refinement, they get playtested for bugs, focus tested for engagement, and iterated upon to bring a high level of polish. Machine learning historically didn't really fit that. Secondly, it doesn't support the game development pipeline. It's fine for a programmer experienced in machine learning to mess around with these tools, but tweaking learning rate parameters or neural network configurations is a whole bunch of technical mumbo-jumbo that game designers typically don't understand and frankly shouldn't have to in order to get on with their job. Lastly, the resources required to train each system was a deal-breaker. Whether it was the time taken, the data required, or the sheer financial cost of running these systems, it wasn't worth the effort. Now, this isn't to say there hasn't been any effort to put it into practice. We already mentioned the likes of Forza's Drivatar, which is one of the longest-running machine learning applications in the industry. But prior to that, there was the likes of Lionhead's Black and White, and the AI Critters and Creatures, which are notable examples of machine learning for games. But these were anomalies rather than a reflection of an ongoing trend in the industry. Given the more recent advancements in AI research, we're now seeing a change in the tide, as more games utilize machine learning for NPCs and opponents, ranging from the likes of the AI drivers in the MotoGP series, the enemy AI in Hello Neighbor 2, and as mentioned already, the campaign AI in Age of Empires 4. But for the most part, game studios still rely on tried and tested symbolic AI techniques when designing characters for games. And this brings us to the big secret. The real AI revolution happening in the games industry is taking place elsewhere. We're seeing significant investment in machine learning technologies for games, but it's all happening in other areas of video game production. Right now, we are seeing an increasing number of machine learning applications in games for areas that aren't non-player characters and enemies. Instead, it's designed to support the future of the industry and seeking to improve game productions. And in each case, it plays to machine learning strengths. It's capturing interesting patterns and datasets and using that recognition to yield intelligent responses. So let's go through some examples of this. First of all, way back in episode 45 of AI in Games on the AI of Hitman, I discussed an approach that computed optimal blend points for animations. This concept has expanded beyond Hitman into a more complex and nuanced approach typically referred to as motion matching, and is now used in everything from The Last of Us Part 1 and 2 all the way to FIFA. And this has been expanded to enable animations to be increasingly more flexible, thanks to machine learning capturing movements across rocky terrain, handling unique geometric features, responding to obstacles, and compensating for the character's direction and rate of motion. We'll be returning to this in a future episode of AI 101 to discuss in more detail. Another obvious one to pull from earlier episodes is texture upscaling. We talked about this at length in episode 61 of AI in Games, where the idea is to train a system that will learn how to generate a copy of an existing image, but at a higher resolution in a way that still looks crisp. As detailed in that video, this concept was originally advocated for by modding communities to up-res classic games, but the more recent work in the Mass Effect Legendary Edition highlights that this is a concept that can be applied at scale in AAA studios. And of course, we can't ignore the work in upscaling graphics in real time as well. Deep learning is powering the likes of NVIDIA's DLSS Super Resolution technology. What this means is that machine learning is being used to take the output of a game and increase the resolution of the final image by being trained to look at lower quality and higher quality images and figuring out how to do that interpolation. This allows for users to play games at 4K resolutions without melting their graphics cards along the way. This is a topic I discussed both in episode 62 of AI in Games, as well as my dedicated NVIDIA DLSS 3 video that explains how this technology has evolved in recent years. Perhaps one of the most exciting ideas that did make some public traction is quality assurance. Having AI systems playtest games isn't just a fairly useful tool, given the ever-increasing size of projects, it can also help alleviate a lot of the pressures being placed on QA teams, who, let's face it, are often not treated very well by certain companies. In fact, we've talked about this already back in my videos on the AI of Division 2, in which they used symbolic AI methods to have bots run around and test missions and the open world. This has since been expanded upon by a variety of companies that are training bots with machine learning that can learn to play a game and in doing so find issues as they go. We saw Electronic Arts' early work in this space make headlines as they had ML bots playing Battlefield 1 back in 2018, and they're still researching new systems that conduct more rigorous coverage of issues in a game world. In fact, this is a big priority for EA, given they started using symbolic AI bots to test Battlefield 5 as far back as 2018, and have continued updating their testing tools for everything from Star Wars Battlefront 2 to Apex Legends and Battlefield 2042. And it's not just EA. Smaller companies like Model AI are now developing tools that run in game engines to facilitate this for smaller dev teams. Another fun direction is in cheat detection. Recognizing and identifying erroneous behavior by players is often very hard to do. And if they're running cheat systems on their PC, it's very hard to catch it happening lest you run some sort of spyware on their device, which is, of course, not a popular approach. There has been some work in this area that is yielding positive results. While many people will have heard more recently about Ricochet, which is the ML-powered cheat detection in Call of Duty and Warzone, the longer-running system is Overwatch. No, not the Blizzard shooter. Overwatch is the cheat reporting system that runs in Counter-Strike Global Offensive, or CSGO, and players are incentivized to catch cheaters and report them to a team of human assessors who will then act on the data provided. However, since early 2017, there is a secret deep learning system called VacNet that is trained on human-reported instances in Overwatch with the intent that the system will then learn the particular behavioral trends of cheaters. VacNet can then report cheaters to the human moderators in the same infrastructure as humans do via Overwatch. The big difference is that the AI has been found to be significantly more accurate. Depending on a myriad of factors relating to the game's ecosystem, a human reporting a player via Overwatch may lead to a conviction by the moderation team only 15 to 30% of the time. Meanwhile, with VacNet, the number of successful convictions increases drastically to 80 to 95% of all reports filed via Overwatch by the VacNet system. These are just some of the many areas that machine learning is being employed, and to go into even more detail would result in a non-exhaustive list, and I do need to finish this video eventually. That said, I refrain from mentioning the likes of text and image generation, given at the time of this video in early 2023, the likes of ChatGPT and Stable Diffusion have not proven themselves to be valuable in regular video game productions. Time, of course, will tell whether the recent boom in these techniques may result in something fruitful and practical for the industry. And so, with this episode of AI 101, we're painting a picture of what machine learning is and how it can be used in games, but ultimately this is all at a very high level. In future episodes, we'll dig deeper and look at specific techniques and applications, ranging from neural networks to reinforcement learning, clustering techniques and diffusion models. We have a lot of ground to cover, and I'm hoping you'll stick around to find out more with each new video. Thanks for watching this episode of AI 101. I hope you found it interesting and learned a thing or two about a thing or two. In the video description, I've linked to some useful materials, be it other episodes of AI in games, textbooks, and a few other bits and pieces that might help if you want to dive into this subject in more detail. AI in Games is a crowdfunded series, and it's thanks to our supporters that new videos make their way to your eyeballs. Check the links on screen and in the description to find out how you can support AI in Games via YouTube membership or on Patreon, and in return you get early access to new content, bonus videos, ad-free podcasts, your name in the credits, exclusive merch, and much more.